here from NTNU, and he'll tell us, he'll give us an overview of gravitational wave physics. So, please.
Today we did for invitation, and today I would like to overview of the gravitational wave physics. I'm not an expert on this field, so basically I just tell you what I learned in the past half a year. Okay. And in fact, we have formed a group that is called the Taipei Gravitational Wave Group, and we have three faculty members. Myself and the two colleagues from Gangnam University, and we are joining Kagura Corporation for helping building the database pipeline. And in fact, we have held a three-day workshop, three-day mini school on gravitational wave. And then later, Link, I will put all the video except one lecture on this website. So if you are interested, you can go there. There are also a lot of lectures not there. So it's a 3-day workshop. So today I just a summary of what I learned in this 3-day to a 19-minute talk. So this is basically my outline. I will talk about the basic of gravitational wave from the black hole, binary black hole. We have two black hole systems, and then they rotate into each other, and they will emit the gravitational wave. So basically, I will talk about the basic. And then one thing important is that how do we detect the signal and how do we do the analysis to find out what is the source. So I will mention the data analysis in a very sketch sense. Then I will talk about how do we go beyond the Newtonian approximation, because as the binary black hole rotating quicker and quicker, in some later time, they will reach a strong gravity regime. So at this regime, the Newtonian approximation will break down, so we need to include in the higher order post-Newtonian correction. I will basically tell you the scheme of calculating the post-Newtonian correction. And then, basically, in the very late stage, the two black holes will merge into one black hole. And at this stage, even post-Newtonian to some higher order is not applicable to this case. So we need to use some resummation trick. So it's called, they call it perfectly one body formulation, basically to extrapolate the post-Newtonian result to the strong gravity regime. By using this, in fact, most of today's gravitational wave binary black hole template was generated by using this kind of formulation. So I basically talk about this formulation. So this is basically online talk. So here I just summary a little bit, a brief history of gravitational wave physics. You can also find something similar in the Wikipedia, and it's in Camry. Of course, it's a very long history, it's about 100 years, so I cannot tell everything. So the gravitational wave actually was discovered by Einstein himself right after he formulated general relativity. And he got the idea that you can have the electromagnetic wave, you should probably have gravitational wave. And of course, at the very beginning, it's not so complete. So Eddington thing is nonsense. So in some sense, they find some gravitational wave propagating in any speed of light, any speed. So he analysis and found it's nonsense. Of course, very soon people realize it's not the case. So basically, it's a summary by Weyl. W-E-Y-L. Okay. And in the 1936. Einstein and Lawson lower paper and submit to Fickle review. They claim that they know gravitational wave. Okay, basically, they find out that we know that the gravitational wave was basically from a linear approximation, and Einstein tried to find the exact solution for gravitational wave. And then once you go to the nonlinear regime, you lost everything about wave superposition property. So they conclude that they cannot find the gravitational wave. Gravitational wave solution is not physical. And then they submit to BRD, Fickle review, and the referee, actually Walker Robertson, find out they make some wrong claim because they understand the singularity basically from the source. Okay, so in some sense, they reject the paper, and Einstein cannot accept that, so he never published paper again on Fickle review. the submit to. And later, Lawson got the idea to talk to the Robertson, and he knows that they are actually wrong, so they submit to another journal, and then they correct their conclusion. Okay. And in fact, in the Landau leadership textbook, you can find a treatment about gravitational wave in the linear approximation, even in the 1941. And actually, there are also a reformulation by Pioneer in 1956. They actually write in terms of diffeomorphic invariant of object. Right? They find that they can use the Riemann tensor as the observable for gravitational wave. And the most important progress may come from this year. I think first Feynman, they find that actually gravitational wave carry energy, and then this can cause some physical effect. And later also Bondi realized that. And in the 1962, Bondi Major and Sack, they formed a so-called BMS coordinate to describe that. And then they had a revival, of course. Soon enough, many people know that, okay, gravitational wave makes sense. So it takes about 50 years for people to realize, even theoretically, it's the right thing to study. And then experimentalists try to detect the gravitational wave. So first, Weber started to do that. In the 70s, he claimed that he discovered the gravitational wave. But as we know that by middle 70s, I think the strain is the sensitivity of strain only up to this level. And today we know that if we want to discover gravitational wave, they will find order more to increase. So it's not possible to detect anything from above gravitational wave at 70. Okay. And then in 1974, we know that Hughes and Taylor, they find indirect evidence for gravitational wave by studying the in spiral companion star, and this is the first evidence, the possibility of gravitational wave passes through the decay of the period of the companion star. So it's not a direct proof. Okay. And in the meantime, there are many theoretical physicists. They start doing a more serious calculation about gravitational wave. So right from 1980, the Bramsha and Damon, and Damon, especially the group and Bramsha, they spend lots of time to calculate the post-Newtonian calculation. Even until today, you still people calculate up to the 5 post-Newtonian order, and they still continue. So it is a huge industry. And Kipson and Weiss in the 1984 they start initiate LIGO, and the LIGO scientific community was formed in the 1997. And then they start running in the 2002. Okay. And then people now formulate the EOV is very important in the late time for discovering the gravitational wave around 2000. And the most important, there are also some progress in numerical relativity. It takes about 30 years. Final people really can simulate a black hole in spiral start from 2006. Before the computer program cannot work, the program will stop very quickly. Okay, so it cannot finish any in spiral to the merger phase. So this is a very important progress. So based on this, we can know that if we have two black holes, they will what kind of the pattern of gravitational wave. Then you can compare to the detection to the experimental observation. And we know that the advanced LIGO have discovery in the 2015 and the 2016, they find the fourth or third, you can say the third discovery. Okay, so, and then the people start to think about the next generation. So now the sensitivity tend to minus 21, and the people would like to hope to enhance more sensitivity so we can have more precise prediction. So this is a very quick summary of the history. And then I will talk about some basic gravitational wave, especially only for binary black hole, because we have many different sources for gravitational wave. For compact object, we have also neutron star binary, or we have neutron star black hole binary. But because the neutron star phase is more complicated, it's involved in the nuclear reaction, and so probably need more help from nuclear physics. And at this moment, there are many scenarios. It also depends on the question of state. So I won't talk about this. Yeah. So I will focus only on a very simple system. It's a two-binary black hole. Basically, black hole carry no hair. So in some sense, from very far region, it's just a two particle. So you have a very simple problem about two particles. They rotate each other and they radiate gravitational wave. So this simplification is, in fact, a theoretical lab for us to do some calculation and make the series. Okay. So everyone, I assume everyone here know what is the general relativity, especially I think the previous talk by Yonghan also say something about this. So basically, gravity tells that gravity is due to the curvature of space-time. And the space-time curvature is sourced by matter. And so the space-time has dynamics. So it's no longer just a platform, it has dynamics, as many physical systems. And they can evolve, obey the evolution equations, which are just Einstein equation. On the right-hand side, it tells you how curvature is curved. How space-time curve, and on the right-hand side, tell you it's related to the source. And if we don't have any big source, our space-time basically Minkowski space, so it is a matrix of Minkowski space. However, we can perturb the space-time, so we add a perturbation. And if this perturbation is small, we can linearize the Einstein equation. Otherwise, Einstein equation is complicated because it's nonlinear. And if we plug in and get the linear, we can get such kind of linear equation. So of course, it depends on some gauge choice, but if I choose a simple gauge, I can have this linear equation, and it without source, it's completely just like a usual wave equation. So in some sense, we know that at linear approximation level, we definitely have gravitational wave. Okay. And because gravitational wave equation is massless, so we will only expect we have only 2 degrees of freedom. So you need to get friction on physical degree of freedom. So usually we choose a more simple gauge called a trace, and trace is a transverse gauge. And by choosing the gauge, your metric looks like this. So you have only 2 physical components. One is called H plus, and one is called H cross. Later on, you will know how we call this. And then we can solve this kind of equation, the Einstein equation, linear like Einstein equation, and then we get this kind of solution. So basically, the retarded, it's just like a Maxwell equation. If we have a source, and the source will be retarded. Especially by reducing the equation of motion, we find that the source on this side is related to particle moment. Okay. Unlike in the electromagnetic wave, we have the source as in some sense just a dipole moment. So it means that if you don't break the spherical symmetry, it's possible to get the gravitational wave. So if the motion keeps spherical symmetry, then there is no gravitational wave. So we need at least 2 body notation which break the rotational symmetry. And there are some notation you can, this is detailed, it's not so necessary. It just means how to take the TT gauge for many quantities. So we know that this fact without gravitational wave from the spherical motion also come from Volkov's theory. So it's everything is set. So basically, we just look for the quadratic, quadruple moment source, and then we can calculate gravitational wave. So that's a very simple source and wave equation. And then once we have gravitational wave, we need to observe the gravitational wave. So we call this a strain. Means that the gravitational wave will deform the space-time, strain the space-time. Then how do we measure that? So basically, we use the Newton's law. So if we have massy particle feel a relativistic force, so the Newton's law will look like this. It's proportional to space-time curvature change, and also the displacement. And then if there is a gravitational wave induced, so there is a perturbation. So in some sense, this perturbation, before without gravitational wave, there is no force. Now we have gravitational wave, this curvature tensor is related to the strain HTT in this way. And the M is the test mass of your particle. So you measure gravitational wave by measuring how this test mass move. Okay. And then, so this test mass, of course, move according to the geodesic equation. But once you have force, the geodesic equation is solved by the force. So this force is just what due to the gravitational wave. So the motion of the source is driven by the gravitational wave. And then we can solve this equation, and then we assume that the position at the beginning is static, and then the motion is just due to gravitational wave. Then we can integrate out this equation, and we get this. So this is why we call it strength. It means that it measures the deformation of the displacement with respect to the original size. So if we can, so what we, if we measure this, we can know the signal of gravitational wave in this way. Okay. And in TT gauge, as we said, we have only two modes. One is H plus and one is H close. And it's just, in Cartesian coordinate, it's just related to this way. Okay, this is basically the diagonal element and this orthogonal element. And physically, it means that if we have a bunch of test mass form a circle, then once the gravitational wave comes in, for the plus mode, actually deform like this. So they deform straight in the either x direction or y direction. But for all plus mode, they stretch along the 41 degree of lines. So we have different mode of polarization. So we basically need to take care of this. Yeah. And this is why the transparency I borrowed from T. Zhang is talking in the school. And basically, this is the people using Michelson interferometer to measure displacement. I'm not sure. Yeah. So basically, we have the interference here. So if the mirror was moving, sometimes the interference will move from the contraction phase to the destruction phase. So you observe the change of the photon count, you will know by the displacement. So it's basically this kind of idea which we can measure. Of course, the motion, the displacement is very small compared to the whole size. I will tell you how small it is. Actually, it's a 4 kilometer long, and but its sensitivity, the strength is 10 to minus 21. So you time that is smaller than the proton size. So it's very amazing that people can really achieve this. And for more detail, you can see in order to make if we have only Michelson interferometer, in some sense it's only 4 kilometer long. And we hope that the photon can inside the cavity can move longer. So actually, we kept them in the so-called Fermi Perot cavity, so they can move 1,000 times more before they go out to the photon detector. And you can see the laser power is 25 watt. If you have some idea about atomic physics, you know, but it's not very high power laser. And we will soon realize why we cannot. It's so high. Okay, so basically the setup if you are interested. So then I will give you some number about what is this LIGO type detector, some number you can have a sense why it requires so high sensitivity. So basically we want to measure the displacement of the N meter, right? We have the N meter. So basically, we hit the meter here. They were just moving. Okay, we want to measure the displacement of these two M meter. And of course, we use laser light. And it's a microwave laser light. So the displacement is about the wavelength of the laser light. So it's 10 to minus 6. And it's the length of the interferometer is 4 kilo. So it's about 10 to 3 cube power. So the sensitivity, if we just using Michelson type sensitivity is only 10 to minus 9. Okay, so it's enough to detect 10 to minus 21. Okay, so we need to add a Fermi Perot cavity. So as I say, it's increasing the effective length by 3 orders. The light will move 1,000 times before it going out. So by doing this, you got the 10 to minus 12. Okay, and how can we increase that? So this just maybe the movement due to one photon. If I have many, many photons, in some sense, with high power laser, I can increase that. And then by this, usual large number hypothesis, we know that we have the high power. And it's photon is photon like a random walk. So basically, you enhance the sensitivity by square root of the number of photons. So if we have 10 to 18 photons per second, then actually we can increase like 10 to minus 21. So this is how this number was achieved. And actually, the detector have many, many different noise. You see, it's a very complicated noise. This total one is, this is the total noise. So you need to separate that, especially if we're interested in gravitational wave, the frequency for the LIGO detector is about the same as the human voice. Okay, so basically you can hear the gravitational wave. It's more easy to look into the spectrum. So it's about from the few hertz to 100 hertz. So we need to make the sensitivity lower, the higher, so especially near the detection regime. And there are many noise. For example, we have thermal noise, and we have seismic noise. And also, the one fundamental noise is called quantum noise. So because you use the photon to detect the motion of the meter, so the photon itself, the quantum object, so they the quantum noise. So quantum noise, it looks like this. Okay. And so even you can compensate a lot by other noise, there are some fundamental limit on the quantum noise. Why we have the fundamental limit? Because there are two types of quantum noise. One is the noise called a radiation pressure noise, because your photon hit the meter, so the photon fluctuates, then the motion of meter also fluctuates. And they are also called they are also called noise called a sharp noise, because photon is a quantum object. So each time, it don't know when it will emit. So it emits randomly. So naively, this radiation pressure noise is like the amplitude fluctuation of the electromagnetic field. And the sharp noise is like the phase fluctuation. And we notice the amplitude and the phase actually form conjugate pair. So we have Heisenberg uncertainty relation. They cannot suppress at the same time. So if you suppress one, you will increase the others. So this one, even we can increase, we can reduce the sharp noise by increase the amplitude like this. But once we increase the amplitude, it will also increase the radiation pressure noise. So then the so-called standard quantum limit. You cannot bypass. So it's also a problem, how can we bypass the standard quantum limit if we want to reduce the sensitivity, if we want to increase sensitivity higher. And of course, there are different frequency dependence for these two types of different noise. Yeah. And actually, there are already some proposals about more than 10 years ago. And now people are thinking about constructing the third generation gravitational wave detector, and they are proposal a long time ago. And here is one of the proposal is called a speed meter. The speed meter means that you are not measuring the position change of the meter, you are measuring the velocity change of the meter. And if you know a little bit about quantum mechanics, in some sense, there is no uncertainty between the different depending on the velocity at different time. So in this case, you are measuring the velocity at different time to measure the phase change. Then in this case, you don't have the standard quantum limit constraint. So this one of the proposal, and people have studied some proof of principle experiment in the 2010, and it's what proved that this did work. Of course, there are maybe the other way of going around the standard quantum limit, but it's one of the effort people try to do that. So for this talk, I will only focus on binary black hole, especially in the spiral phase, means that before the two black holes are merged together. And in some sense, the simplest system in the gravitational wave emission. And in this problem, we have three scales. One is the black hole radius. Okay, I call coil is RS, and then the distance between the two break coils is called the spiral radius, is capital R. And also we have also gravitational wave length, finally it's emitted out. And we see that the black hole mass and the black hole radius are related as in the Schwarzschild solution. So basically, we have this kind of relation. So for example, if our sun forms a black hole, the radius is just 1 kilometer large. And we try to understand the Newtonian approximation, when the Newtonian approximation is a good approximation. So basically, we have a relation between different scales, which are proportional to the velocity. If velocity is very small compared to the light speed, then the Newtonian approximation is good. Otherwise, you need to take into account the torsion Newtonian fraction. So for example, these two scales, the Schwarzschild radius scale and the orbital scale, they, from the capital law, you know that proportional to v squared. And there is also the frequency, radiation frequency. And this proportion of V over lambda is the inverse proportion to wavelength. And again, the wavelength is very long, and compared to the rotation radius, is also proportional to V. So they have some relation like this. So in some sense, the ratio of the three scale is proportional to V, or V squared. So you can using V as an expansion parameter when you do the post-Newtonian expansion. And the typical frequency of a binary breakout, we can, from Kepler law, we can have this relation to the mass and the size of the radius. And then we transform into this, so we know that it's about 19 hertz or 20 hertz, and then if your breakout is about 3 sun mass, and the radius of these two breakouts are separated by just 500 kilometers. So in this case, you will radiate about 20 hertz frequency. And this one, exactly this kind of frequency are what we observe in this three discovery event. And also we can understand why strength of the black hole should be like a 10 to minus 21. And then you from this, we have calculated the solution for Einstein equation. So the strength basically proportional to RS over R. R how far of the source from Earth, and RS is about the capital I that's here. So you, and epsilon is the eccentricity, because we hope the system will not be moving in the perfect circular sense. There is some eccentricity. Eccentricity is not very high, it's 0.1. And if we write this, if the source is away from Earth by 1 gigaparsec, then we get, and the epsilon is about 0.1, and the m is about the sun mass, then it's about 10 to minus 23. Of course, the mass we observe today is about 20 to 30. Both black hole is about 20 to 30 mass. So it's readable, we get a 10 to minus 21. Okay. And also, the gravitational wave luminosity from this binary black hole is very huge. You can calculate, you see it's 10 to 57 Earth per second. So it's almost like the flux in the whole universe. So if we have two 30 mass black hole, they will radiate away about 3 sun mass into the gravitational radiation, and it converts to the flux is very high. Of course, because it's very far from Earth by about 1 gigaparsec, so it's still very weak when the wave arrives to Earth. Yeah. Any question at this moment? So basically, in this black hole spiral trace, we will see the gravitational wave like this. This is called a trap signal. Trap is some birds singing, okay. So the frequency and amplitude will increase with time. So